Hey folks, David Frost, my strategic forecast. You're here for another episode of Common Sense Market Analysis. Today is Thursday, September 13, 2018. We're looking at a daily chart of the SPY or Spider, which is the proxy for the S&P 500. And we had an update today, obviously, but it wasn't an update across the board. We'll get to that in a moment. However, let's talk or focus right now on the SPY or the S&P 500. So this is what I was really referring to. So this was somewhere in the neighborhood of the target, maybe slightly lower. 290 was my actual target, knowing that certainly the market could go higher. Now, we have no signal of a trend change or anything like that, so I'm not suggesting that the market can't go higher, but I'm on the lookout for signs and a signal of a trend change. I didn't expect the market to get much higher than this. In fact, I would have been satisfied had the market got to about 290, even give or take. That was really where what I had in mind. So when you look at this, you say, well, is this an area where we could potentially put in a lower high? It is. Could we still go higher? Could the market make new highs? Absolutely it can. So until I get verification, any kind of signal or confirmation of a trend change, I'm not doing anything on the short side. I'm just letting you know my thought process when I look at this daily chart. The first thing I see is a very solid uptrend. However, there are some other factors that are playing into my analysis that have me thinking that we could see the market have somewhat of a decline or at least somewhat of a correction for a few weeks. And that's why I'm on the lookout for a lower high situation. But that doesn't mean we have to have a lower high situation. Let me just pause here for a second and thank everybody for continuing to participate in posting comments underneath the video each and every night. I love the comments. I love the participation. I love the interaction. Please keep up the great work. Thank you very much. In addition, hit the like button on the video and share the video with anyone you think can benefit from this information. Now, back to the S&P. So, in terms of the spider chart, the weekly close is going to be important. If we close near the highs, if we close around where we are today, even higher than we are today, that's going to be significant in terms of the weekly close in my book. So, I'll be anxious to see where we close the week based on Friday's close. We'll talk about that in the next video. Drilling down for a moment to the hourly chart, is there anything that stands out, anything we need to be aware of? Well, from near the lows, you can see where we basically did a stair-step routine higher with a gap or two in between, and we're still making bullish consolidation. Maybe we want to get up to test this breakdown candle high again. We already tested it kind of, sort of, one time. Maybe they want to get a little higher. Maybe they want to fill the gap up here. It's not that far away. That's certainly possible. It's certainly possible into a Friday. If, in fact, we have light volume in the market, across the markets on Friday, is it possible they float the market up into the weekend? Absolutely, they do it all the time. Something to be aware of. Do we have to go higher? No, but still, there's a lot of resistance. There's a lot of overhead resistance in this general zone. Closing a week, for example, tomorrow's close, above where we are today, that's going to be bullish, and that's going to lead me to believe that we're going to test the old highs and likely exceed the old highs, and that would likely happen sooner rather than later. How much higher? Well, what I'm really discussing here is maybe a dollar, $1.50 in the spider higher before the market would stall out again and likely retreat. And what that translates to is roughly about 10 to 15 S&P points, and what I'm suggesting is the market can exceed the old highs by roughly 10 or 15 points, but my expectation is that we would have a difficult time closing, maintaining closing prices above that level, and we would likely retreat. But can we make new highs? Yeah, it's possible. I don't know that it's probable, but it's possible. How about the IWM, my favorite market leading indicator? Now take notice. Let me go back to the spider for a second. Take notice. While the volume was still below the average volume, the last few days we did see decent volume on the upside. We saw more volume as the market came down, but we didn't see terribly or exceedingly low volume on the way back up, but still below average volume. We can't really make heads or tails of that. I'm just stating what it is. But look where we are visually on the charts, number one. So we just want to take notice of visually what it looks like. Then we're going to go back to the IWM and also take notice of the fact that the spider was up about 0.5%, $1.63 today. The S&P 500 was up about 15 points. Now we go back to the IWM. Does it look the same? Well, it doesn't look tremendously different, but if I drill down a little bit and take it from a shorter term perspective, for example, over the last, let's say, week or week and a half of trading, what I can say is that we're consolidating in a bearish fashion right on top of the 20-period moving average. So I did make the case yesterday that we may have completed that short-term pattern to the downside yesterday on that little flush early on. That is possible, but until and unless we close above the breakdown candle high right here, which comes in at 172.48, until and unless we close a day above that price, then I'm still in the camp that we can see some overhead resistance and downward pressure in the IWM. Now, the other thing I want to take notice of is we noticed the spider was up about 0.5% today. The IWM was basically flat. So we have what we discuss or call relative weakness in the IWM against the spider. The IWM is my favorite market leading indicator. The IWM had relative weakness all day long today against the S&P, so I was taking notice. So it is something I'm paying attention to. And when I go down to an hourly chart, let's take a look at the hourly chart of the IWM, and then we'll go back to the spider chart and remember what that looked like. So that looked bullish, and it looks like it wants to go higher. Fair enough. We take each chart independent of one another. Does the IWM say the same thing? Well, if I take it from a very short-term perspective, I can make the case that we can have a bullish pattern that wants to go higher, and it looks like this. So we have an up move, and here we have a pullback. We tested the lows. Can we move higher and test higher on this breakdown candle? Yes, we could, and that would satisfy the IWM moving up at the same time the SPY bullish pattern plays out to the upside. That is possible, but all in all, that's not really what I see here. What I see is a channel working its way downward, and I see not the same look as I see in the SPY. So I'm curious on which market is going to catch up with the other, because that is what's going to take place. Either the SPY is going to turn around and catch up on the downside and get the same kind of look as the IWM, and or the IWM is going to sell off farther, or the IWM is going to turn around, and if we go back up to the daily chart, what the IWM is going to do is it's going to turn around and go back up to challenge the high of the breakdown candle. That is the candle from the 6th of September, and or it's going to close above the high of that day. So either one of those two things is going to take place. One market will catch up to the other. We just don't know precisely which one it's going to be just yet. Since we don't have all the answers yet, we continue moving on. We continue looking on at other charts. And what we find in the VIX is another down day in the VIX. And what's interesting is we're coming in to test the low of the breakup candle, right? So that's where we are. We're not quite there yet, but we came close today. The low of the breakup candle happens to be the 1224 number, and today's low happened to be 1230. So that's close enough. We tested the low. Can we spike through the low? Yes, we can. What's going to be important is where we close each and every day. If we close below that low, that's going to be significant to me. If we don't and we continue holding that low and we turn around and start upward again, that's going to also be significant. That's going to be a bullish pullback pattern holding in the VIX. That would tell us lower stock prices ahead. But if that low breaks and we close below there for tomorrow, example, or for example, tomorrow, pardon me, then that's going to tell me that we're likely going higher in stocks. We're likely going to test the old highs in the S&P and likely going to exceed the old highs, maybe by 10 or 15 points. That's the schematic that I've built in either direction. Either we're going to put in lower highs somewhere around where we are right now, or we have higher highs coming in short order. Going over to take a look at the transports, we have my second favorite market leading indicator. Now, we had the S&P up 0.5% today. We had the Dow up 0.5%. We had the NASDAQ composite up 0.75%. We had the transports down 0.4%. And we had the IWM flat. So my two favorite market leading indicators were really in different directions than their major market indices. I find that interesting and intriguing. So you know what I'm going to say. We're above all the moving averages. We got far extended away from home base or the 20 period moving average. So what is the market doing? It's going sideways to lower, letting time eat off the clock, letting the 20-period moving average move up to price, and at the same time, letting price move down toward home base. That's exactly what's happening. We talked about that a couple of days ago. That's precisely what's going on. There's nothing technically wrong with this chart. We're just really working off an overbought condition in the transports. That's it. Nothing more, nothing less. If we got below the breakup candle low, that's something different. That may be something else developing. But until and unless that happens, we're going to treat this as a garden variety pullback in an uptrend. Nothing more, nothing less. Close below 11,375. That's give or take. That's rounding around this breakup candle low. Any close below there and something else is developing, and we'll discuss it if that does happen. How about the Qs? The Qs are doing very similar or the same thing that I was expecting the S&P 500 to do. And you can see here that we're going to have trouble getting through this breakdown candle high in the Qs. So we can consider that overhead resistance for now. Close above that. New highs are coming, no doubt about it. We've been discussing the XBD, the relationship between the broker-dealers, the financials, and some other external factors that may or may not be going on. So we'll take a look at the XBD, which happened to be up nicely today, up over a dollar or 0.5%. But we've been down so much that I can't consider it anything other than just a dead cat bounce. When we look at the weekly chart, we can see what's developing here. You can see a weekly bearish pattern developing, playing out. It has more to go on the downside, so it just takes time. They don't all happen all at once. Sometimes they happen all in one candle like this, all in 1 week, and sometimes they don't. But this has more to go on the downside. Likely support area is down here at this pivot low, which comes in right around 258.5 in that general zone. That will essentially complete this bearish pattern from this weekly chart. So give or take, there's another 10 points to go in the downside in the XBD to complete the pattern that we've been talking about for quite some time. Looking over at the XLF, the XLF came in to test its 50-day moving average today, and it held but closed below the 200. So it'll be interesting to see where we close the week in the XLF. Remember its weekly chart. We got all excited that the XLF got bullish, but remember, it could be bullish all the way up to this general zone in the $29 neighborhood. We got close. We got not close to 29, but we got to 28.72. So we started to make our way up to challenge that. Now we're selling off from that general zone. Whether or not we go and test that or not, we have to keep in mind that this is a bearish pattern. We've been discussing this for a long, long time. And the fact that we have yet to close above the high of that breakdown candle leads me to believe that as long as we stay above these moving averages on a weekly basis, the 50 and the 20, that we may continue to test the high of the breakdown candle. But getting back below those moving averages is not going to be a good sign for the XLF. Here's a chart of the SMH, or the exchange-traded fund that tracks the Philadelphia Semiconductor Index. And before we go on with this, I want to make mention of something else, which is I appreciate the feedback on some of the market psychology ideas. I'm going to have another couple of minutes segment tonight. We're going to discuss, and we'll just do it after we run through the markets. I'll come back to discuss, or at least open up a discussion about why sometimes, or a lot of times in some cases, which is unfortunate, but why are our losers larger than our winners. And I have some ideas on that concept and why that takes place. I want to discuss some of that. We'll open up the floor, and then hopefully we can get some interaction going with postings underneath the video. So let's finish up the markets, and then we'll circle back to that. So the SMH, you know, we had a tremendous rally off the lows that were made yesterday. And so take in mind that this isn't really, you know, we had a tremendous rally from 102, or what was the low yesterday? The low was 102.16, and the high today was 106.76. That's really a lot in a very, very short period of time, just a matter of hours. But what you want to take notice of is, you know, while this, we can make a case this isn't an uptrend as long as we continue closing above the 50-week moving average, but the more we teeter on the 20-week moving average and the more we continue to test the 50-week moving average, the more likely we're going to be at some point in time to break through on the downside the 50-week moving average. This is essentially climbing the 50-week moving average. Ultimately, this can break down below, and if it does, look out below because there's a lot of room on the downside. I'm not saying it's going to happen anytime soon. I'm just saying if, in fact, we close any week below the 50-week moving average, that's going to be a big warning sign across the board. Now, I'm not the only one that knows about that. There would be a lot of professional money managers that would be watching for an event like that to take place. They do watch the 50-week moving averages, and they do watch the SMH, among other things. And therefore, just want to bring it to everybody's attention. Just something to keep in the back of your mind. It's a puzzle piece. It's a tool in our arsenal. That's it. Just keep it in the back of your mind. And now we'll move on to the gold market. And in gold, you can see here we're edging up to the 50-period moving average. That should come as no surprise to anybody. The high has been $1,218. We said around $1,220. You know, that kind of satisfies, for all intents and purposes, the 1220 that we talked about, or the 50-period moving average. We may or may not continue higher. I'm really not 100% sure. If we continue going sideways for longer, I'll expect higher prices. Right now, we're in between the 20 and the 50-period moving average, have somewhat satisfied within reason what I expected on the first try of around the 50-period moving average. So for now, there's no trade on for me. I'm just an umpire calling balls and strikes. As long as it goes sideways, still can see bullish and upside momentum. And we'll just leave it at that. Let's go over to the crude oil market. Look at that hit crude oil took. Here's the activity from the 13th, which is today. So the next candle is the electronic session leading into tomorrow, the 14th on Friday. This took some hit. High, $70.28. Low, $68.35. So that's one of those two-handle days in crude. Still weren't able to get up to the 72 level. Something quirky was going on. This is interesting behavior. It's really bearish behavior in the big scheme of things. The market's acting tricky. And usually when a market acts a little bit tricky, it's getting ready to make somewhat of a larger move. And sometimes it could be in both directions. Sometimes we can spike up to $74, $73 a barrel and then sell off from there. Or we can just sell off. But my thing is, I think that we're finding longer term overhead resistance. And I think the market's beginning to act tricky. And I think we have lower prices in the nearer term rather than higher prices. Higher would be 72. How much higher can we get than 72? I'm not sure. A whole lot higher. I don't see us breaking above or closing above this breakdown candle high. That comes in at 72.76. If we did, I'll change my tune and I'll flip it around and we'll probably have a lot higher prices coming. Right now, that's the line in the sand. 72.76. That's on a daily chart closing basis. All right. Why is it that in a lot of cases, our losing trades tend to be larger in dollar amount or percentage terms, and both, obviously, than our winning trades? And there's a lot of reasons for that. There are a lot of technical reasons. There's a lot of psychological reasons. There's a lot of reasons that different people or different traders do different things. We chase markets. We move our stops around. We do things we shouldn't do, even though we know we shouldn't do them. For some reason, a lot of us do them anyway from time to time, or more often, way more often than we should. And those are part of the things of learning how we need to rein in our own psychological behaviors, our own emotions, understanding ourselves. Part of trading is understanding what each of us is capable of doing as individuals. It's much larger than trading. And there's really two topics here. There's really a second topic that I just invented or just decided to bring up. I think it's an important one is, you know, there's a bigger picture going on here. And that's why we always have to keep in mind the stock market and the charts that we see in front of us is a very, very small component of a very large universe. And I don't want to get too far out in left field on you, but just stay with me on this for a second. So we discuss Mother Nature for argument's sake, and we know that we can't control Mother Nature. So if we think in terms of that, then we know that there is some force out there that controls the weather, that controls Mother Nature, that controls natural disasters. All those things are controlled by some force. The force controls a lot of things, including us, and that's where our emotions get tied in, because something controls our emotions. Whatever we want to believe it is doesn't really matter, but we need to recognize that something is controlling our emotions. So our objective is to get in control of our emotions. In order to do that first, we need to understand our emotions. We need to understand ourselves, what we're capable and incapable of doing. For example, the type of trades that we take as traders. Not everybody is comfortable taking the same type of trade. And that's where emotions may play a role in how we act and react getting into and during a trade, and the reasons why we may get out prematurely or too late. So for example, I don't like momentum trades. I don't like to buy higher expecting to sell high. That's not necessarily for me. And you can probably guess that if you've listened to me and watched these videos any length of time, you know you rarely ever see me do anything remotely close to that, and nor do I shorten the hole. I don't like to sell after a market's already been down a significant amount. I would rather buy something that's on sale. I would rather sell into overhead resistance. That's the way I operate. So other traders have a better time and more success buying momentum than I would. So they're more comfortable buying momentum. Maybe they're not as comfortable buying into various support areas. Some traders see some of what I do as catching a falling knife sometimes. I don't see it that way. I see it as buying at a very important price and time in the market, and those are the times, that's the spot that you want to take those trades. That's the way I view what I do and how I teach my students, at least in part of the work we do and some of the patterns that we do, and how to buy stuff on sale. There's other patterns that are bullish patterns, that are upward momentum patterns. You know, there's bullish pullback patterns like we've just talked about tonight a couple of different times. That's fine. Those are different, but understanding what we're capable of being comfortable with and not is important in trying to get a hold of our emotions in the business of trading. So the bigger picture is something is controlling our emotions. We need to understand where we find success and frankly where we don't. In order to do that, we need the data. And here's what a lot of traders don't do. And I know why they don't do it. What I'm talking about is analyzing their own data. The reason they don't do it is because they're afraid of what the data will tell them. They know they're in a losing proposition or a losing situation, or they know they're not doing well. They know they're not doing things correctly. Therefore, they don't look at their own data because they know the answer. They already know in the back of their mind what they're doing wrong, so they don't need their other alter ego to tell them what they're doing wrong. They already know, so therefore they don't need the data. Let's move on to the next subject. Well, guess what? That alter ego, or the first ego, whichever ego, is wrong. You need the data because you have to be honest with yourself to uncover where you're going wrong in your trades. You'll find amazing information in your own data. You will find information such as, hey, look, out of all these losing trades, as it turns out, 60% of my losing trades happen to be short trades that happen to be after the hour of noontime or thereabout. Well, guess what? When I see that in black and white, really easy fix for that is stop shorting the market in the afternoon, specifically when the volume is light, because the trades tend not to work. Why? We talk about it all the time. The path of least resistance is up in light volume. How do you think I figured out not to short the market unless you have an absolutely premium trade on your hands in light volume or in the afternoon? It just doesn't work on too much of the time. So all of a sudden you look at your own data and you'll be crazy surprised by what you'll find. Look at what you're trading, when you're trading, the type of trades you're taking, time of day, amount of trades. What were the stocks or the market doing at the time you took the trade? Go back to review the trade. Did you chase something? Did you buy at the exact wrong time? Did you buy at resistance because you were chasing? Did you sell into a hole? Did you sell near support and got whipped out of a trade? I understand we don't want to know. We know in the back of our mind we did that, but we really don't want to see it in black and white. I have news for you. Go see it in black and red. And if you're just honest with yourself and you stop doing the things that you know you shouldn't do and you know that don't work, all the things we discuss in the course at Lazy E-Mini Trader, you know what's right, you know what's wrong. If you follow the rules, you can make money. If you don't, you'll likely lose. That's the real story. Why do we lose more than we win? So why do we lose more money on the losing trades than we win on the winning trades? That's the question. And I know that that happens to a lot of traders out there. And I just switched charts on us. Here's a chart of AMD. And I'm going to wrap in another story into that scenario of why we lose more on the trades that we lose than we win on the ones where we win. One of our traders, Mike, who was kind enough to send me an email with good news this afternoon about his trade in AMD, told me exactly where he got in and what happened. He was short AMD and took a nice part of the ride down, most of the ride down in AMD. So I want to show you his entry and where his exit was, because his entry was really picture perfect. But I want to use this as a great example of what happens to us because our emotions get in the way of our decision making, and we end up taking profit too early and we end up taking losses too late, meaning we take losses too large. So here's what happens. So Mike took a trade here, and he actually took a trade right around the breakdown candle high on the short side of AMD, and he wrote it down all the way down where this candle closed, I believe, if I remember his email correctly, into the early part of the afternoon. That's a tremendous trade. Congratulations, Mike. This is right out of the course at Lazy E-Mini Trader. Mike took the course. Mike's made other trades like this. I like when Mike tells me about these trades because I can use this information as a teaching tool. And tonight, let's take a different approach. Let's say, not Mike, but somebody else got in the trade one candle earlier on the short side and took the ride down and all of a sudden was in the money pretty nicely, or even one candle earlier. Let's say they jumped the gun and they got in the short side down here. So let's just call it $33 for argument's sake. Thinking that AMD is going to go down, we're shorting it at $33. We think this is a bearish pattern in the making. It's going to go down farther. That's what we see happening. All of a sudden, what happens is we start out of the money. And we start out of the money, and all of a sudden we're out of the money, and maybe in this example, it wouldn't have been that much. Maybe it's only 15 or 20 cents in the AMD example. But in another example, when we start to get out of the money by an uncomfortable amount, we start to contemplate cutting the trade loose. We start to contemplate hitting a stop, or moving our stop, or getting out of the trade. We start to, our mind starts to play games with us. We start to think unclearly. We don't like the fact that we're losing money. We're down, and I'm making up numbers, right? Because everybody trades a different share size, so it's different for everybody. $100 loss is uncomfortable for one trader, and $1,000 loss is where another trader becomes uncomfortable, and all the way around. So What happens is we're down $100. Okay, I'm starting to get uncomfortable. All of a sudden, we're down 100 and a quarter. I don't like it. I'm starting to think I'm not going to let it get past 150. All of a sudden, we're down 70. All right, things are getting better. You know the routine. And then we get down. All of a sudden, we don't stop out at 150. Now we find ourselves down 2 and a quarter. Now we're down far more than we ever really wanted to be on that trade. Now we're thinking in terms of, oh, am I going to hold this overnight? Did this trade just become an investment? What's going on here? When's this going to snap back? What happens if I'm down $350? All this stuff runs through our mind. Then all of a sudden, at some point later on, the market or the stock we're in begins to creep back and we begin to get close to even. We're within $100. We're within $50. We're almost even. Now we're back down 100. You know the routine. I don't have to go on any further about that. Finally, we're in the green. Now we're up $25. We're up $50. We're up $80. We're up $170. Finally, we have some relief. We're feeling pretty good. Now all of a sudden, we're up $60 and we hit the bid. We're done with the situation. I'm not taking a loss in this position. I'm getting out with a gain. It didn't work. I'm done. Okay. And the reason why you did that was because you were down more than you ever wanted to be, which shouldn't have happened, number one. And number two, you cut it too early. You're not giving it time to play out. You disregarded the reason you got in the trade, which was potentially a good entry point, and you let your emotions dictate the exit for a different reason altogether, because you just decided that you didn't like the feeling of being down $325, which is what you just experienced. I just lost my train of thought there real quick. My phone rang. I hate when that happens. But nevertheless, what I was leading toward was we let what just happened recently, being down more than we wanted to, dictate our next thought process and really take over the trade. And the technicals and the chart really had nothing to do with anything any longer. What happened was, A, one of two things. It will have A and B. A, either the entry was bad, which is the reason why the stock went down more than it should have, and therefore, that was an issue of our own technical analysis and a bad entry or not a good enough entry or not being patient enough to wait for the right entry. Sound familiar? Or B, the market or the stock, whatever we're trading in, went down farther than we thought it would, and we got to an uncomfortable position, which tells you something different. A, you didn't stop out when you should have, following the rules, or B, you're trading too large of a share size because you got into an uncomfortable situation real quick. So those things are other things that we need to consider. We need to do this right. We need to treat this as a business. This is a business. Once you start treating it as a business, that's when you start making money. And with that, I'm out of wind and I'm going to wrap it there tonight. I'm David Frost, My Strategic Forecast. Thanks for tuning in for another episode of Common Sense Market Analysis.